quarter mile, Paul puts away flowers for Lisa. Back markers start to run home. Race Me Home has a shot, so does the Scotsman. At the inside and Rich Daddy, and they're followed by Zulu, and they're at the top of the stretch. The rail is open for Rich Daddy as they get to the top horses. Aztec Sense with the lead. Rich Daddy threw on the fence to try to kick with him down the center and Race Me Home. Zulu is next. In deep stretch, it's Aztec Sense for the lead. Rich Daddy takes another run at him. Aztec Sense, Rich Daddy, it's Aztec Sense in the jewel.
Good morning, everyone. Ron Nicoletti along with Acacia Courtney, and that was Aztec Sense winning the $200,000 jewel yesterday, one of three wins for the trainer, Jorge Navarro. And we were just talking before we came on the air. I thought that horse didn't have a chance.
No, it looked like, coming around the quarter pole, it looked like he was pretty much done at that point, but just found another gear. Big run from Rich Daddy up the rail as well. And as Ron said, three wins yesterday for Jorge Navarro to start off the meet with the claiming crown. Also three wins for jockey Chris Landeros, two claiming crown races and a maiden race. So fantastic day, up 14% in handle. We crushed last year's record. So big thank you to everybody that came out and joined us yesterday for opening day.
It was such a fun day. Boy, you can get around. It had that feeling of an opening day. It was really a lot of fun. So we move forward today. It is Sunday in
Yeah, well, just wanted to give a reminder, too. We're happy to have everybody back with us on Sunday. Just a reminder, lots of great stuff happening with racing, but the North Bar is open as well.
That's
used to be a Tiki Bar, so don't forget to go and check that out if you're on track with us here today at the top of the stretch.
She had to get that bar in right away. I know where we'll see Acacia after the races tonight.
She's not throwing me under the bus so early in the morning.
No, greatest bartender in the world, so go out there, and it's a lot of fun. They finished the new tent, the Tiki area. It's still a work in progress, but great TVs. Mm-hmm. You get sound, you got betting machines. So head out there if you get a chance. Now we'll see what we have to offer this afternoon. And we're going to start the day. There's our wagering menu in the first race today. We got the super high five. Anytime we have seven or more starters in the race, we got the super high five. You can have an early pick five.
Yeah, I got the early pick five home yesterday, which was pretty exciting. So we'll see if we can keep that going. We have a nice carryover for day two in the Rainbow Six, nearly 22,000. We had that big guarantee yesterday with the Rainbow Six pick four and pick five. So lots of good stuff still today.
Yeah, we got that final pick five. Acacia will have a ticket for you in just a little while. And speaking about the early pick five, we're going to start the first race off with a 1 mile turf race to starter allowance, 3-year-olds and up. And I know you have a ticket you want to show them.
I do. We'll show you my early pick five ticket here. I do have a single, nice and affordable play to start the day on this Sunday afternoon. But hopefully you padded the bankroll yesterday on opening day. There were some big prices yesterday too. And we'll start things off with three horses here in the opener. You have some really strong barns present too, and a great jockey colony this winter as well. I'm going to just single in race number two. I think that Zalza dropping in class for trainer Marcial Navarro just looks like the one to beat. So trying to keep it affordable. Maybe if you think that one doesn't have a chance even on the drop, you need to spread a little bit more. Again, just a base ticket to show here. Using two horses in race number three, what will we get for Barbarossa, who seems to have been a little bit tricky to figure out running against tougher, now in for the $16,000 tag. In race number four, I'm going too deep. And the fifth race is another wide open maiden race that also starts the Rainbow Six. I think you really need to see improvement from some horses. So I use the spread method there in the cash out in race five.
Yeah, I got the 5, 6, and 7 when I show you my Rainbow Six ticket. I think those are the logical, but good going with four because that is a wide open affair. And that is exactly what we're going to see in this first race this afternoon. We were talking before we came on the air. I said, oh, look, my horse is currently favored now. Then her horse was favored. Then the three horse was favored. And it's very early in the wager. That's how it's going. But I know you like Coolin' Rock this afternoon.
I do indeed. This one first off the claim for trainer Mike Maker. Gets Luis Sias in the saddle, who did have a winner yesterday on opening day, last year's championship meet winning jockey. And we'll show this last race on October 26th at Belmont. My birthday, actually. We'll show the race for Coolin' Rock. This horse was the number 9 that day. It was towards the back, actually last early. And you can see there was probably a little bit of moisture in the turf course, maybe kicking up a little bit. But I thought that there's the number 9 closing far far, far outside, the widest horse of all, just not quite able to get there to the wire first. But given how wide he was in the trip that he had, I thought it was a really good performance. And Ron, we saw closers do very well here yesterday.
Yeah, on both turf and dirt yesterday, and it looked like the inside paths were okay, and that's usually not the case here at Gulfstream Park. So we'll see how the races play out this afternoon. But if you had the right horse, you could win from anywhere on the racetrack, put
yes,
it that
absolutely.
Way. That's a better way to explain it. But I want to show you a stat that I found real interesting with trainer Mike Maker with Kulin Rock. Domestic shippers shipping into Gulfstream Park roots on the turf. He's pretty solid. He's 44 for 215, 20%. That is a big sampling. He's in the money 47% of the time and still has a positive return on investment of $2.15. So when he ships those horses in to make their first run, it's a good stat.
And that is amazing that it's just turf root races yeah. and it's that many horses.
Hey, imagine if you put turf and sprints, it would probably be 1,000. So when you see it in writing, it's it's amazing to you. But Mike does an incredible job all the time. So I did go with the number 5 in here. You got third on your ticket. Discovered he's cutting back to a mile, returning to the turf this afternoon after following. It was a second place finish on the grass. That was in a 9-furlong, $100,000 Jefferson Cup. Comes back, stalks and fade. But that's against allowance runners. It was going a mile. It was on the Churchill main track. I like this horse going back to the turf this afternoon.
I do think that the turf is his preferred surface. And he has that early speed, which really will be one of his best weapons. In fact, Julian Leperu in the saddle. He and Mike Maker actually teamed up for a win with Peru yesterday. That makes it, by the way, 17 claiming crown victories for Mike Maker, which, talking about those crazy numbers, is just insane. But yeah, this horse makes a lot of sense. I did, again, prefer Kulin Rock in the way that he ran, but I don't think that there's really any main knocks against Discovered. We'll see what kind of trip he gets and if he's able to maintain that speed.
And the horse is probably going to be favored when the smoke cleared. It is the number 10 Lemon. It's 4 for 7 in the money on the turf. It's Pletcher. You'd think this horse is going to run well in there and probably going to end up being the favorite. So a very interesting race to start the
Absolutely.
Afternoon. Tough to handicap, but we like that. So let's go to race number 2 today. It's a 6-furlong sprint. These are maiden claiming 2-year-olds. And I went to the inside, and I know you got your single in here. So let's start with your number 9, Zalza, and tell us why you singled this horse.
Well, looking through the rest of this field, mainly the reason that I singled this horse was because I didn't have a strong enough opinion about anybody else in this field. I think that the number 1, Guerreron, makes a lot of sense. It's just that he's had quite a few tries already. Zalza has only had 2 starts so far. It's only been against state bred meet in special weight. Now, he is, I think, now championship meet versus what he was facing at Gulfstream Park West, going to be a little bit of a step even claiming to special weight, but it's still a very significant drop in class. And given the way he ran in his first 2 starts, a drop was needed. He's got a Misael Jaramillo staying in the saddle as well, who rode him last time.
Yeah, for all the reasons you mentioned, I mean, you got to have this horse in your ticket just on the drop, but I did go to the inside horse, and he was dropping to the 16 level, made that 4 wide bid last time out. He finished an even 4th. It was against 25 maidens going 3/4 of a mile. As you mentioned, he's had some chances. I really respect the job that Armando De La Cerda does, and he's got Luis Saez in the saddle last year. 137 victories,
Amazing.
I believe it was. Yeah. So, and he had a win yesterday for Todd Pletcher. So there's a perennial leading a trainer and jockey. So hard to leave that one up the ticket. And how could you not have Vinny Van Gogh on your ticket? I just like saying Vinny Van Gogh when he's there.
I should have known you were going to like that one.
He's getting some class relief. He finished 5th. That was on the turf going 5 furlongs. I thought he was illogical to grab a
What chair. About WW Handsome?
Yeah, well, I was too meager to say that.
Let's he doesn't go, like to brag.
Let's go to race. Let's get away from that race right now as quick as we can. Race number 3 is about a mile and 7.5 furlongs on the turf course, 3 and up. Non-winners of 2 races in life. And the number 9 I have on the ticket, Barbarossa, I'll kick it off. He's dropping to the 16 level, returning from the 6-month layoff. He tracked the pace. He finished a distant 5th. That was a 40,000 2-lifetime claimer. Was up at Belmont Park. Trained to Todd Pletcher, Luis Saez handling the stretch out to 7.5 furlongs. I thought he was the logical one.
He is the logical one on paper. And Ronnie's been a bit of a head scratcher, I think, probably for all of us that are trying to handicap. And it looks like for the connections as well, because I know that he started out with with very high hopes for this horse. And we saw him running at Saratoga. We saw him in last year's championship meet. He was beaten just a neck behind Mock Tree in a really very salty, if you remember that race at the end of December, a very salty allowance race. We saw him in the Texas Glitter run pretty well as well. And then it looks like they just haven't been able to really kind of figure him out since then. He had a layoff, not quite sure the reason for the layoff. Came back with a poor performance for the tag. The fact that he came back for the tag and then takes another drop, and a significant drop at that. Sometimes we see these Todd Fletcher horses take that big drop and win by a pole, and that's very well what could happen in here. I think you have to use him. But he certainly does, I think, have his own fair share of questions.
Well, it's blasphemy. No, that's who you put on top of the ticket. That is the number 10 horse, and here is his claiming tag carved in half today.
He does. And this one, I think the drop is logical for this one, and I don't think that it's a questionable drop at all. Last time out, ran well, beaten four lengths from an outside post at Gulfstream Park West. I think, again, now coming to the championship meet, what he's going to face, this is a good $16,000 race that he's going to face.
Yeah, I split those two horses with the 7, Bound by Luck. He's breaking mid-pack. He departed from an outside post last time out. He stalked the pace. He finished fourth against this level of competition. Jane Sibelli and Nick Warr has been riding in real good form since the kid came back from that little bit of an operation across town at Gulfstream Park West. He ran exceptionally well. So I think the race goes through the 9, maybe in the 10 in that particular race. We'll go to number 4 now. Race number 4 is a 7-furlong sprint, and these are maiden special weight 2-year-olds, and that's always a lot of fun here. Interested to see how you went. You went with the number 6 horse in here, Archie Dust.
Yeah, this one's second time out for trainer Jorge Navarro. Ran a solid race in debut. It was on a wet track at Monmouth in September, but it's been training really sharply at Palmetto's. And I do like that 6-furlong work, 2 works back at Palmetto's to kind of get a little bit more stamina after the freshening, debuting at 6 furlongs. It's a big jump for the 2-year-olds to go from 6 furlongs to 7 furlongs, which is what he's going to run today. So I like that kind of stamina enhancing work. A lot of precocity on the bottom side, a $300,000 of Verrazano.
Yeah, you know, and he's $300,000. I did go with the number 7 here, and it's Forever Mo, who you have in second, who's the son of Uncle Mo. He's going to turn back to a sprint distance this afternoon. He pressed the pace. He faded through the stretch when finishing 5th. That was going a 2-turn mile across town at Gulfstream Park West. It is Antonio Sano. Going to add second time blinkers this afternoon for that turn back to 7/8 of a mile. So I just thought this horse had some bottom in going around those 2 turns, that he might be a logical contender in there.
Absolutely, and you bring up the great point that a mile at Gulfstream Park West is 2 turns, whereas here at Gulfstream it's 1 turn. So it is a significant turn back here to the 7/8. But certainly you'd have to imagine first time blinkers maybe was a little bit more keen than they had anticipated showing that speed.
And the number 1 horse in here, Cobble Hill, is a half brother to a grade 1 winner called Marley's Freedom. Is debuting for Todd Pletcher today with Lasix and Louis Saez. Want to show you stat of Mr. Todd Pletcher. Got to start the meet off with a Todd Pletcher angle in here. 2-year-old first time starters, maiden special weight, right here at Gulfstream Park. He's 21 for 64, 33%. He's in the money almost 60% of the time, and he's got a $1.80 return of investments. And there he's telling Acacia that he's going to win this race.
He certainly might be, and it must have been an error by my part because I did have this horse in my ticket. I don't know why I have him, don't have him in my top 4, but certainly, as you said, the pedigree speaks for itself. And how about a couple of high-priced 2-year-olds in here by Verrazano? It's always fun with the 2-year-old races to see how the sires do end up panning out.
Yeah, they had one Verrazano. I forget the name of the horse now. They had tied into Verrazano Bridge, but I thought it was a great name. It escapes me now, which is not, you know that part. You know that story.
He's gonna escape over the Verrazano Bridge.
You know what we're gonna do? We're gonna take a break, and when we come back, we're gonna have my Rainbow Six ticket.
Whether you're at home or at the track, have a stake in the race when you bet with ExpressBet. Sign up for an ExpressBet online betting account and receive up to a $500 sign-up bonus.
Welcome back to Gulfstream today, Ron and Keisha. Great working back with you again.
Always fun.
We were just mixing yesterday. I never saw you the whole day.
Well, I was all over the place the whole day. I don't think I sat down, but hey, it was so much fun for opening day.
It really was, and the weather was perfect, and we got the same situation this afternoon with that fast main track, firm turf course. We got that carryover in the Rainbow Six. We'll go with my ticket, $43.20, and I went three deep in here. We were measuring this early when you showed your early pick five ticket, just how wide open in this race, so I went three deep with the 5, 6, and 7. You know, it was almost thinking in race number 6, the single, the number 5 commute, Jorge Navarro first off the claim, but I threw the 6 in there. My long shot today comes in race number 10. It's the 8, and it's Art Collection from the 1 and only Scooter Dickey, 12-1 on the morning line, and that is a great race this afternoon.
That is a really good race. I mean, talk about wide open and just a lot of different ways to go, and that's always fun for the handicapping. Like your ticket, I, too, consider it single and commute. Looks like the horse to beat in there.
Yeah, you know, I just wanted a little coverage in there. I'm not totally sold on it. And this is a fifth race, a mile on the turf, maiden two-year-olds. They're going to run for $20,000, and it's a pretty nice field in here. And we both went with the number 6, Majestic Hero, on top of our ticket.
And I do think that this one, switching back to the turf for trainer Bill Mott, it's only run on the grass once. It was on a good turf course at Kentucky Downs in Special Weight Company. So I don't think there's really much stock that you can put into that performance at all from this two-year-old colt. It's for trainer Bill Mott, Louis Sias in the saddle, working well at Payson Park. And some horses love the Kentucky Downs surface, some hate it. It's a very quirky track, and especially when there is some moisture in the turf. Also now in for 20,000 versus Special Weight on the grass.
Yeah, and the Kentucky Downs, I never know where the stretch is. All
right.
Of a sudden, some switches, and they got another eighth of a mile to run somehow in there. And now the horse you used in second, which I also have on my early my Rainbow Six ticket, Just Kitten You.
Well, we're going to go to that last race at Keeneland, which was a softer turf, and I wanted to show the head on of the break here for the number 6. So keep an eye out. It's easy to spot the Ken and Sarah Ramsey red silks and the red blinkers. You see, took a little bit of a turn and then just slammed on either side, and so just never really had a chance to get any position early on. That being said, I have been seeing with the softer turf at Keeneland this fall that quite a few horses have done that, kind of lost their footing a bit at the break, but Just Kitten You has done this in the last two starts. So the key for him with Tyler Gaffalione up the third time is going to be getting a clean break.
He needs the clean break because he had that same trouble, as you mentioned, at Ellis Park. Now, I did use the number 5 on our ticket. As you can see, we're basically have the same super, just mixed up a little bit. Channel by the Wind is making his local return after showing a tactical speed in that race. He just got nailed late. He was the favorite that afternoon. That was in a pair of 7.5 furlong turf outings across town at Gulfstream Park West. It's Peter Walder. He's got Paco Lopez trying to repair the budding reputation as a chalk burner.
Right. Yes, his last three races, he was the favorite and he was beaten. So he's got a lot of work to do now. You could say, okay, well, last two were at Gulfstream Park West. Now you've got to prove it here at Gulfstream Park. But that speed certainly is going to be one of his keys.
Well, let's go to race number 6 this afternoon. We're going back to the main track. It's a 6-furlong sprint, allowance optional claimer, 3-year-olds and upward. And being race number 6, it kicks off our late pick 5.
All right, we'll show you my ticket here. I kept it $36. No singles here at this point. I did, like Ron, consider singling Commute. First off the claim for Jorge Navarro here in this first leg. Going too deep in race number 7. That's a race I might use a little bit more coverage in. I think that's a pretty wide open maiden race. Just not really quite sure which direction to go. Nice race in race number 8 on the turf. $16,000 claimers. And we always talk about this, that $16,000 level on the turf are just absolute war, super competitive and fun to watch as well. 9th race, I'm going with 2 horses. And then, like Ronnie, I like a bit of a price in the last race, in race number 10, 9 furlongs on the grass. I'm intrigued by the number 1, Western Crusader. I think he might be bet down come post time. I think he's something like 20-1 on the morning line. Yeah, 20-1 on the morning line. So we'll see what we get from him. But I do think he's got a shot in that fun nightcap.
Well, I'm liking that. Dueling long shots in the last race. This is going to be a lot of fun. So you know we're going to have a little wager who finishes in front of the other there. So let's take a look at this sixth race. And as we mentioned, we've been talking about this horse Commute. He's moved to the Jorge Navarro Barn via. They went and jumped in and got this horse for $62,500. Returns to the main track, chased the pace, but he finished fifth, but behind a really good horse. That horse, Hembry, came back to win the Grade 2 New Arctic Stakes. So this one in Navarro, he's not as good claiming, you know, from turf to dirt, but he does a good job. And Commute, I think, is solid, the one to beat.
And, you know, it's funny. I actually looked up a stat because I said, well, you don't normally see him go turf to dirt. And first off the claim, turf to dirt in the past 5 years. Normally, first off the claim, he has a lot of horses. Right. But first off the claim, turf to dirt, 6 for 19. So a small sample size, but still 32% win, 63% of the time in the money. Just $1.50 ROI, but do think that it was big.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good stat that you know out there. And I just think he's doing good. He does great with that. It's a small sampling, as you mentioned. Now, the other horse that I used on the ticket besides Commuter's Field Trip, and this is the one I had to add to my Rainbow Six ticket, a winner of 3 straight races here before finishing third. That was in the Millions preview across town, the sprint preview across town at Gulfstream Park West. He returns. Going to try and recapture that horse for course status. He likes this track, 3 for 3. I couldn't leave him off the ticket.
I know. It really is pretty impressive what he's been able to do. I probably should have gone back and used him again. He was beaten by a really nice horse last time out in Croy as well. Surprised to see Field Trip was the favorite ahead of Croy last time too. But do think that he's pretty solid. I don't think you can leave off the one Scam. You have him too. He's just been so consistent lately too, and he is He's got to step up, I think, against this field, certainly based on the class that he's been facing, but very consistently right there.
Yeah, he's a 5-time local winner, so he really likes this track. And one of my favorite angles when everybody arrives back here at Gulfstream Park, you look at horses that like this surface in the past. Race 7, 6 furlong maiden claiming filly, 2-year-olds. I went with the 6, and so do you. Enough. And then some.
I thought I was being a little bit clever picking this horse, but not so. This is Ron and I are already thinking the same.
Poor Acacia.
Well, I thought that this horse on the drop for Henry Colazzo, two solid races so far.
Yeah, and I thought there was an 11 thank you note. Is the $75,000 daughter of Uncle Mo, owned by Todd A. Pletcher, trained by Todd A. Pletcher. He's going to be the favorite in that race, but I like the 6 along with you in there, just maybe off those 2 good performances in there. I think you get a decent price. It's not going to be a great price. Mm-hmm. Race number 8 this afternoon, I'm skipping a race here with my paper sticking together, is about 7 1/2 furlongs on the turf. Claim is fillies and mares, 3 and up. And another race that's tough to handicap.
This one is tough. And I went back and forth between a couple horses in here. And I ended up going with the number 8, Scatnap. And certainly Safi Joseph Jr. does a really good job spotting horses in the right place and claiming. But Victor Barbosa also does a good job claiming horses and putting them back in the right place. So one last time out as the favorite, this 5-year-old mare who's been popular at the claim box as well. She, too, has an excellent record here at Gulfstream on the turf and thought a big win last time out across town. Gets Luis Saez up, too.
Yeah, I like her in there, but I did go with the number 9 that you have in third on top, and Son of Towers returning what has definitely been her favorite surface. She's had 4 races here, 3 wins in a third. She showed some early interest last time out. She faded. That was against entry-level allowance competition in her Parks finale in the slop. It's Jorge Navarro, Edgard Zayas back in town. He was up at Tampa yesterday, had a little trouble with Pay Any Price breaking through the gate and getting loose, but he's fine. He's back. Son of Tara, certainly a major player in the spot.
And it comes out of a key race.
Well,
I should have known you were going there.
You knew I was going there automatically, and I closed it out with a Tara. But what about the one?
The one, Reagan's Odyssey. I like this horse quite a bit. We're going to go back to her last race. This was on November 2nd, was the number 9. I thought that this was a pretty good performance from her. We're picking it up where she has now moved up towards the lead. She actually was parked about 3 wide early, and she was a little bit wide coming down into the stretch. She pulled away and ended up being caught late. It was a very, very close finish. And you can see, we've seen sometimes Gulfstream Park West, a little bit more tiring track. She's getting tired here, but still hung on very gamely. I think that she's going to be a nice price given that performance that you could include in the exacta.
Yeah, I mean, she ran very well in that spot, so we'll see how that race plays out. And we'll go to race number 9, the first half of the Elite Daily Double today, a 6-furlong sprint. Claimers 3 and up, $6,250. And you say that, and you go, what? It's some of the hardest knocking horses you'll ever
see. They really
are. I mean, Dash and Dazzle is certainly looks like they claimed in 8 of his last 12 starts, including 4 straight. If you see Dash and Dazzle, claim them.
Right, that's apparently been the thing. He's an 8-year-old gelding. He has won his last 3 races for 3 different connections. And so now making his first start for trainer Jorge Delgado, picking up Tyler Gaffleon. We'll see who claims him today, but he seems to run. And these horses that are claimed so much, it's obviously word is out. They protect themselves. They run no matter where they are or which barn they're coming from.
Yeah, and the sound.
Yes.
That's the main thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why these guys keep jumping in. Hey, I'll win for this one this week. I'll win for that one next week. So we both used the number 9 Be A Hero. Really solid performances on this track. 4 starts, a couple of wins, a second. Jorge Navarro, he better have a good day today. He seemed to be mentioning his name an awful lot. He certainly had one yesterday. This one had a really productive campaign up north. He won 3 of 6 races. And look at this, what I like, he's a 6-furlong specialist. He's won 9 of 21 races going 3/4 of a mile.
That is pretty impressive to be so good at this distance. And this is also a reclaim by Navarro as well. He had this horse last year in 2017. Ralph Nix had him for a couple starts, and then Navarro claimed him back. And as you said, had a very good summer with him.
Yeah, and we used Pachanga Party. I used it in 4th. I used it in 3rd. And you got the 2 horse in there. So we're pretty much in agreement in that particular race. One of those last 2 flip-flop. Now comes the big one of the day. Race number 10. And this is a mile and an 1/8 on the turf. It's an allowance optional claimer. And it is a great betting race. And that's why you look for long shots in there. Because it's pretty equal field. But you try and look that when where you might get a price. I'll start with the number number 8 Art Collection, making his local return. Forrest Scooter Dickey, as I mentioned earlier, he ended his campaign in Kentucky. He had trouble starting 8, but it was really a competitive group of allowance runners at Keeneland. He's a lightly raced 3-year-old. Want to show your stat on Mr. Scooter Dickey with his horses shipping in to Gulfstream Park. All levels on the turf. He's 4 for 16, 25%, 50% in the money. And look at that return of investment. And look at that smile, $6.53. So Scooter, one of our favorite people here at the racetrack. And this horse can run, believe me, and you might get a bit of a price.
That's a great stat to show, too. Yeah. Really, really good, nice stat there. As we said, nice win yesterday for Julien Leperoux as well. So we'll see if he can keep that momentum going. I think that the number 4 second mate on the drop for Jane Sibelli. We haven't really seen much from Jane just yet here, but she usually does tend to send horses that are ready to run for the championship meet. So this one's been consistent. A good record here at Gulfstream, but I liked the 1 Western Crusader at a price. This one debuted on the turf at Saratoga. It was a good turf that day, as we all know. Lots of rain up there in Saratoga. That was also going 1 3/8, ran against a very tough field, and then came back, though he broke his maiden on a race taken off of the turf at Delaware, and the last 2 races have been taking off the turf. Trainer Graham Motion is still intent on getting him back on the grass, and I think that that's a sign, too. Comes out of a key race, plenty of turf pedigree there, and some natural speed.
Did you say key race?
It is a key race.
2 winners from 6
2 winners, two winners, exactly.
With that said, there's our long shots. The horse that's going to take all the money here is the 2, Byrne, James Byrne, who's returning to the optional allowance, claiming ranks after ending his campaign up north, a 2nd in the against PA runners in the $100,000 alphabet soup. Its maker spots the 7-year-old perfectly in a nightcap. We're both going to try and beat it.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a long time since he's won, but we've seen Maker do this exact move with horses like this. Maybe you have one that's got a ton of backlash, drop him a little bit, get that confidence back.
Yeah, so it's going to be a fun day.
Yes.
We've got a fast main track, fern turf course. Acacia and I will be with you throughout the whole afternoon and try and give you some useful updates throughout the day, right?
Should be fun.
Good.
Most anticipated thoroughbred racing events of the year returns. The 3rd annual Pegasus World Cup Invitational at Gulfstream Park in South Florida. Drawing competition from around the world with a $16 million purse split between 2 Grade 1 races on the dirt and on the turf. Experience the incredible fashion, spectacular world-class service and entertainment, and the unrivaled unrivaled adrenaline of the Pegasus World Cup Invitational. Saturday, January 26th at Gulfstream Park. Get your tickets now at PegasusWorldCup.com.